courses of Easter, and I think we got five of them completed last week, so we'll try to do the other seven tonight, if time will allow us to do so. And so we're going to begin with the mob, and the mob is the voice of hate. Let me just in case anybody cares and wants to know, you can find this online, and just by looking under the 12 voices of Easter. I think that, I can't remember his first name, Alexander, I think, Kroll is his last name, the fellow that wrote this. And so it's available online, dramatically read, and if you'd like to hear it other than this one. So here's the mob. Scripture passage for this is Matthew, the 27th chapter, beginning with the 15th verse. It says this: Jerusalem is our capital, the major city in our land. It teems with people at any time of the year, but especially at festival time. Jews from everywhere converge on Jerusalem to observe the appointed feast. Our city is filled with crowds, and it doesn't take much to turn a crowd into a mob. A throng is a crowd in love. A mob is a crowd in hate. I've been in a mob or two. I was there when the mob raised its voice in hate. You see, the city was packed with Jews here to celebrate the Passover. I was in the street late on the night of the feast when I saw a group of the priests and the members of the Sanhedrin making their way towards the Roman fortress of Antonio. They went past us in a cold rush. A number of people followed along, curious and excited. Something big was up. I fell in step from snatches of conversation. I soon learned that there was to be an arrest and a trial. Somebody was going to die. We stopped at the gate and waited while the priest went into the fortress. Some of the temple police were there. Torches and clubs appeared and were passed through the crowd. A crowd draws a crowd, you know, and soon there were scores of us, eager, energized, and expectant. The priest banged out through the fortress gate with a contingent of soldiers and led us out of the city to the east. Our torches made little light in the heavy blackness. We were swallowed up in a cool rush of darkness and stumbling, hurried excitement. We came to a garden and found the one they wanted. I was disappointed. I thought the soldiers and the mob, we might be there to surprise some outlaws. I was ready for a fight. But they were after one man who looked completely unremarkable. Evidently, he was a rabbi who had been praying there in the garden with his disciples. He came to us with a greeting of peace. The man next to me pointed and said that was Jesus the Nazarene. I recognized the name. He had caused some kind of trouble in the temple, and the religious leaders were determined to silence him. Jesus was bound and dragged from the garden back into the city to the palace of the high priest. Several of us got into the courtyard of Caiaphas's house. We grouped around the fires, trading guesses about what was about to happen to the prisoner inside. As the night grew old, I found a corner and sat watching the fire. I must have dozed off, but suddenly I was awake. Noise and confusion, pushing and shoving. We were on our way, pressing through the narrow streets, bumped against stone walls. We were heading toward the fortress again. We stopped outside the governor's judgment hall and shouted for Pilate. The council had condemned Jesus for blasphemy. They wanted an execution. We had to make sure the governor would hand down a death sentence. Jesus stood before the governor, beaten and bloody. But Pilate was being difficult, and that just ignited our rage. Pilate challenged us. I find no fault in this man. What do you want me to do with him? The chief priest led the chant, "Crucify him!" We picked it up quickly. Perhaps you have never been swept up in pure hatred. Rage has a mindless strength that no power can resist. I shouted with the others, "Crucify him! Crucify him, kill him, he deserves to die." All this for a man that I didn't even know. Pilate had the Roman soldiers scourging. When Pilate stood him before us and showed us the result, we flew into a blind frenzy. I could see that Pilate was shaken. This man was honest. He delivered Jesus to us to bear his cross out of the city to Golgotha. Crowds lined the streets, mocking and jeering. Every hateful and spiteful emotion anyone had was spent on that man. He bled, he He stumbled, he fell. Finally, the Roman centurion commanded a man coming in from the country to bear the cross for him. All the while, we cursed and railed against this Jesus. We finally made our way through the gate of the city and out to the place the Romans called Calvary, where common criminals were crucified, raised on a cross barely off the ground and left to die. The Roman soldiers nailed him in place, and they uprighted the cross, dropping it into a hole in the ground with a jolt. You could hear the Nazarene groan as the weight of his body pulled against the nails in his hands and feet. The mob spread across the hillside to watch. Most were men like myself, cursing the one on the cross. He had claimed to be a savior. We taunted him, calling him to come down from the cross and save himself. But there were women there too, beating their breast and lamenting him. You could tell that from the agony in their cries that some of them were his followers, but our jeers quickly drowned out their voices. The Jewish religious leaders were there mocking him. The Roman soldiers ridiculed him. We wanted him to die. We relished in his pain and suffering. A strange thing it is to watch a man die. It's a fascinating horror. There's no dignity on the cross, hanging there in public view. The mob feeling drained from me. And I was just one man, watching another man die. He was covered with blood and sweat. The other two whimpered and cursed and pleaded for mercy, but this man was different. He spoke from the cross, but not in anger nor in bitterness. He spoke in compassion to one of the thieves hanging next to him. He spoke to a woman, I guessed her to be his mother. There were words to a man that was with her. There were requests to the soldiers, and as he hung near death, he looked and spoke toward heaven. I heard him call on his Father to forgive us, those assembled as a part of this mob. But how could he pray for our forgiveness after what we had done to him? How could he answer our hatred with love? Yeah, I was in the crowd, part of that angry mob. We raised our voices in hatred. But the one on the cross answered our hatred with love and forgiveness. I don't understand it. He did not live long enough to remember my voice, but as long as I live, I'll never forget his. Then there's the thief. I haven't much time left. Breath comes hard. Death is near, I hope. No one who knows me is surprised to see me end this way on a Roman cross. I've been stealing, cheating, and robbing all my life. Even when I was a boy, I'd run through the market snatching fruit from the vendors. While other boys studied in the synagogue and learned to trade, I was becoming an accomplished thief. I could steal from anyone, anytime, and any place. I never knew my father. I wish I had never known my mother. I learned early to trust no one. Nobody cared for me. And if I had not stolen, I would have had nothing. I have even stolen from the Roman soldiers. I could steal anything and get away with it. Too bad for the Romans. Always hated them. Too bad for everyone else too. I hated everybody. There was no one I could trust. I believed I would never be caught. I mean, I've been caught before, but I could never prove anything. And I believed they never would. I was wrong. Here I am. Condemned to die on this cross, a sign posted above my head announces my crime to all who pass, Illyric or Jerusalem thief. Two others hang here with me. Mathan, he's just another thief like me. I've encountered him on a few occasions professionally, but I preferred to steal under the cover of darkness, but Mathan, he could swindle you in the broad daylight. The one in the middle, I never knew. They called him Jesus. Some have called him the Messiah. Others say he's a magician. He raises people from the dead. The priests seem to hate him. He caused some trouble in the temple. I was familiar with some of the money changers that he chased out, but what was his crime? The centurion posted a sign on the cross above his head, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Must be a crime to be a king nowadays. I'm dying.
Some people die in bed, surrounded by those who love them, who soothe them in their pain and draw a cover over them for comfort. I figured out a long time ago that there would be no one at my side when my time came, speaking words of comfort or easing my fears. The people at a crucifixion have no words of comfort. It's all mocking and jeering and abuse, scolding, berating, insults. It's to make us an example. I realized I'm afraid to die. Nobody comes down from a cross alive. Not that I have much of a life to come down for, but at least I know what it is. I do not know what will happen to me when I die. Tomorrow's the Sabbath. So on this afternoon, they will break my legs, and I will no longer be able to breathe. I thought, I'm going to die. I don't want to die. I'm afraid. Then I thought that maybe Jesus was a prophet. Maybe he would work a miracle. Maybe he would say the word and we would be surrounded by the armies of God like Elijah in the old Bible. He would save us all. For a moment, I actually hoped. But this Jesus didn't look like he was in any condition to save anybody. The soldiers had beaten us all but him. I'd never seen work like that before. The soldiers mocked him. Save yourself. The chief priest reviled him. He saved others, but he can't save himself. I could see my brief hope was empty. So I joined in. If you are the Son of God, get down from the cross. Let God deliver you now. Mathan taunted him the same way, but I stopped. Why didn't he show any anger? Why didn't he curse those who cursed him? Then as Mathan continued his scolding, I rebuked him. Don't you even fear God, Mathan? Don't you see that we're being completely punished justly, but this man has done nothing wrong? How can you continue to ridicule him? Then the darkness came. At midday, it was like midnight. It was eerie. This Jesus must be more than a man. He must be the Messiah. Jesus was dying. He would go to God. He would go, and I would die alone. He would leave me after all. I couldn't bear the thought. With all the strength I could muster, I turned to him and said, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. He was the king of the Jews. I was a thief, but a king can pardon a thief if he wants to. And he said to me, today you will be with me in paradise. Then there's the voice of the Roman centurion. I'm a Roman centurion. I serve not in my home country, but in this God-forsaken land of stones and scorpions. I have about 100 men in my command, but don't be impressed. I'm just a grunt in the Roman army. I do what I'm told. A soldier has his duty. Soldiering is not pretty work, but where would we be without armies? Ask yourself that. The Roman sword and spear are the only foundation for peace in this world. Maybe someday someone will run the world without armies. I'd like to see them try. I'm not saying that I enjoy everything I'm ordered to do, but you get used to it. You lose certain sensibilities over the years. I thought I was hard as any soldier until that day. Actually, it began late the night before when my commander sent word to our barracks at the Antonio Fortress. The Jews had come to the fortress full of their confused noise and about some traitor they wanted to arrest. They wanted Roman soldiers to accompany them. There was no guessing what they really were up to. You never know what kind of crazy fanatics you'll come up against in this cursed land. This was the time of their Feast of Deliverance, and it didn't take too many brains to imagine some deliverer taking a swipe at Rome as part of the festivities. So I gathered several hundred men with me, and we went east of the city, across the Kidron Valley, into an olive garden. A strange company we were. We were led by an informant, and his name was Judas. At his heels, a group of angry priests and religious leaders, a mob with clubs and torches. They had their temple police with them. I had to wonder, what kind of traitor needs to be arrested when both Roman soldiers and Jewish scribes, their clubs and their torches in hand, and alongside the iron of our spears and swords. Well, we arrived at the Olive Garden, and I got my first look at this traitor. We had come with a small army for just this one man. Judas kissed him. That was the signal. Then for an instant, a sudden wave of sheer panic swept over me. The whole troop convulsed in a moment of blind confusion and lurched backward. There were soldiers all over the ground. If there had been an opposing force in the garden that night, we would have been helpless before it. I shouted for order, and my troops recovered themselves. The Nazarene was arrested and taken to the house of the Jews' high priest. I left a small patrol nearby and led the others back to the fortress, but that wasn't the end. It was almost dawn when the Jews brought their prisoner to the governor's judgment hall, clamoring for pardon. The Jews had finished their own trial and wanted the governor to approve an execution. Pilate wasn't interested. It was a matter of their religion. Then they put it in political terms. Jesus claimed to be the king of the Jews. They demanded that Pilate sentence Jesus to death for treason against Caesar. It was easy to see that this man was no threat to Rome. The governor was not convinced that Jesus was guilty of any capital crime at all, but Pilate wanted to appease the Jews, so he told me to have the Nazarene flogged, and I gave the nod. My men scourged him, opening his back to deep wounds, shredding the flesh into pieces. Well, if you've never seen a Roman flogging, you don't need me to describe it. But the scourging wasn't enough for the Jews. They began screaming for his crucifixion. Pilate finally gave in. The men enjoyed their sport. First, we took him to the praetorium and gathered the whole battalion. They mocked the prisoner because he had said he was the king of the Jews. One of them pulled some thorns beside the wall and fashioned a crown. I'd seen that kind of thing before, but for the first time in many years, I winced as they pushed it into his brow. They slapped him. They spat on him. They ridiculed him. I knew we were doing the right thing, and I fought against the new feelings inside of me. You must rule with power and fear, or you cannot rule at all. At least that's what we had always been made to believe. I led the execution detail to the hill outside of town. Jesus had to carry his own cross like any other convict. We crucified him with two others who had been sentenced. Some of the chief priests were there, an unusual audience for a crucifixion. But they weren't finished mocking. They said, "If you're really who you claim to be, then come down from that cross and save yourself." My men, the soldiers, they jeered too. "If you're the king of the Jews, save yourself." I usually joined in too, but I just couldn't. This man, he was no criminal. And he didn't whimper or plead like the others. I've never seen anyone who knew how to die. No cursing. No spite, no fear. I mean, everyone loses their nerve or struggles or whimpers. It's just natural. But to him, not him. I don't mean he didn't suffer. Everybody does. It's just the way he took it. They curse or they cry. They blaspheme their gods. I've seen the toughest criminals terrified. You find out what a man really believes at the cross. You see who he is. And this one was different. The funny feeling I had at the scourging grew in me stronger than ever. Even though I had been trained to believe that crucifixion was the only way to rule, that it was the final solution for all human crime, but watching him on the cross, this was not Roman justice. At midday, the darkness came. I don't mean the sun was shaded. I mean inky, black darkness. Many of the spectators lost their nerve and they ran away. But of course, an execution guard has to remain until the prisoners are dead. Obviously, we can't let a prisoner's friends get him down before the work is done. We usually rotate watches because the strong ones can last two or three days. But as the hours passed, I could see that this man was really close. I stood close and I watched. He looked upward and said, "Father, into thy hands I commit my spirit." And then he died. I mean, he chose the moment. Death didn't happen to him, dragging him away, catching him off guard, struggling to get away. Just like a man chooses his next action, chooses a moment to sleep or sing or to eat, he died on purpose, just like that. Nobody has that kind of power over death. It was a miracle. Then I heard myself say, "Surely, this was a righteous man. I haven't been the same since. I will never be able to look at a cross the same way again. This God-forsaken land, holy men and scorpions. I never expected that a man on a cross could change me so much. It was the way he died. I'm not the hardened soldier that I once was. I've seen the death of a truly righteous man. Now I'll rest until I find out who he was." Then there's Joseph of Arimathea. "Sometimes there's nothing you can do. At least that's the way I felt that night. My last night on the council, I'd never seen the Sanhedrin driven by such mad obsession. I wonder if anyone could ever have said or done anything to deny them their objective. We'd been summoned with great urgency to Caiaphas's house, quite out of the ordinary for the Jewish high court. Inside were the judges and the lawmakers of Israel. Out in the courtyard were the temple police and a mob. And there before us stood a man I had come to know and admire, Jesus of Nazareth. I had come to believe that he was the very Messiah of Israel, the one we had long awaited. And more than that, I'd watched him heal the sick. I'd seen him feed the hungry. I heard him teach in the temple. He was, the more I listened, the more I marveled, the more I loved him. He said he had come to save those who were lost. And I was a respected member of the Sanhedrin. I held a very high position of religious authority. Others on the council scoffed at this man's claims. Let him seek the lost and save them if he can, just as long as he leaves us alone. We've always followed the ways of God, they said, but that is not what Jesus meant. He spoke the very words of God. This man was God's appointed Savior for Israel. I'm not a brave man. I've never shown much courage in the storm of debate. I followed Jesus secretly because I was afraid of the others on the Sanhedrin. They would despise my faith. They would ridicule me. They'd put me out of the council. What would happen to a man at my age then? There would be nothing for me back in Arimathea after so many years. So even though I believed that Jesus of Nazareth was the Messiah, the Savior of Israel, I didn't tell anybody. And then he stood before me and the others on the council. Angry voices derided him. False accusers lied about him. Still my voice was silent. Some of the council objected that this trial was illegal. I nodded agreement. The objections were thrust aside. Our leaders condemned him and sent him to Pilate, the governor, for a sentence of death. Pilate passed sentence and sent him to the place of the skull where they crucified him. I had been waiting for the kingdom of God just as many faithful Jews had. I thought surely this Jesus would gather followers to his side, repel the Roman invaders, and establish the kingdom of heaven. But now my hopes had been nailed to a cross. I'd never paid much attention to the crucifixion. Horrid business, but this one I watched. Jesus hung on the cross in agony, more terrible suffering than I had ever imagined. I stood in the shadows, afraid to approach. I didn't want anyone to see me. I saw him with his arms outstretched as though to embrace the world. I watched him suffer. I saw him die. I believe now that he could have come down from that cross and saved himself from the agony and pain, but he accepted that pain as the will of God. Before he died, he raised his voice in forgiveness. Forgiveness. Forgiveness more powerful than the armies of Rome and the strategies of all our leaders. Forgiveness. Something changed inside me. I decided that my seat on the council was nothing to cherish. It never would again bring any honor to me. I decided that it was past time for me to raise my voice. Perhaps my silent voice might become something better, a voice of courage. The Roman soldiers determined that Jesus was dead. I left Golgotha and went straight to the Tower of Antonio. I requested an audience with Pilate. Because of my stature in the Jewish community, he received me. I worked up my courage and I asked Pilate to release the dead body of Jesus into my custody. Pilate was surprised to learn that Jesus had already died. Sometimes, you know, the victims, they would linger for days. I was not sure what Pilate would do. I knew enough about Roman law to know that those condemned to death had no right to burial. Would Pilate enforce their law? I also knew that Pilate hated us Jews. He had nothing to gain by granting me a favor. But he signed a release. Maybe he saw in me an opportunity to get back at the Sanhedrin for forcing him into this business to start with. I didn't linger to chat with him about it. I sent word to my friend Nicodemus to meet me at the family tomb. I hurried back to the scene of the crucifixion with Pilate's release. I presented it to the centurion and asked him to take Jesus' body down from the cross. He gave me a funny look, then put his men to work. Some of Jesus' followers were standing nearby watching us. So I asked a couple of them to help me carry the body. We took it to my family tomb, which was nearby. Nicodemus was there. He had brought linen, bandages, spices, aromatics, a mixture of myrrhs and aloes. We didn't embalm Jesus' body like an Egyptian would, but we bathed it, cleaned it, rinsing the wounds, his head, his side, his back. And we wrapped it in layers of bandages and the aromatic mixture. It was late in the day, and we had to hurry to finish before the Sabbath. My family tomb is not a natural cave, but rather a hewn out of solid rock. After we laid the body of Jesus in the tomb, Nicodemus and the others helped me to roll a great stone in the entrance. It was a heavy stone and wouldn't be easily moved. Later, Pilate even came and sealed the tomb and commanded Roman soldiers to guard it. Our leaders wanted no one to have access to the body of Jesus. When I think back on these things, it surprises me that I had the courage to do what I did. I knew that my actions meant the end of my term on the Sanhedrin, the end of my good name in the community, the end of everything I had thought so important in my long life. The entire world knew that I was a believer in Jesus the Messiah. But what they thought no longer mattered to me. In the face of deep sorrow, I was thrilled to find my voice. And what a happy surprise to find that it was the voice of courage. Then there's Mary Magdalene. I'm one of the 12 voices of Easter. Mine is the voice of adoration. Jesus changed my life. He loved me when no one else did. I've almost forgotten the days before. I will not speak of them. I will speak of him. I followed him wherever he went. I was always in the crowd when he taught. I saw him raise the dead, heal the sick. The blind saw, the lame walked, the deaf heard, the dumb spoke. Those bound by evil spirits were released by his command. I was one of several women who followed him. We were not as close to him as the 12, Peter, Andrew, James, John, and the others. But we constantly felt the warmth of his smile and the gentleness of his voice. He loved us as much as we loved him. But then the leaders of Jerusalem arrested him and killed him. I stood at his cross, watched him die. I wept to see him suffer. The Roman soldiers were cruel. Our leaders were no better. The chief priests and scribes, they mocked him. In his agony, they hated him. But Jesus had told us beforehand that this was the hour for which he came from the Father. He said he was laying down his life of his own accord and that no one was taking it from him. We stayed there all day from morning when they drove the nails through his hands and feet into the cross until it was over and the soldier drove a spear into his side. Late in the afternoon, a strange thing happened. A member of the Sanhedrin approached the centurion in charge, and someone said he was Joseph from Arimathea. That was a town about 20 miles away. He showed the centurion a document. The soldier took down the body. But what was he going to do with it? We followed him. As they carried it out to a tomb nearby, another rich man met him there, and they worked together quickly, preparing the body. It was almost the Sabbath. They didn't have time to finish. They had time only for washing and wrapping. They laid his body in a new tomb. It must have belonged to a wealthy family. We watched and remembered the place. We wanted to come back and anoint the body properly. We spent a long, cheerless day together. As soon as the sun set, the bazaars opened. Mary, the mother of James, Mary, the wife of Cleopas, Joanna, Susanna, and others of us hurried into Jerusalem and bought spices needed to anoint Jesus' body. We decided to go the next morning, early in the day, when we could go without notice. We rose in the cold and dark and set out. The sun was still behind the hills of Moab when we made our way down to the dark path to Joseph's tomb. Someone asked how we would move the stone. That's right. We had watched Joseph and the others block the entrance of the tomb with a huge stone. How would we ever move it? And there was a report that the Roman soldiers had been posted to guard the tomb. What would we do? But when we arrived at the tomb, we were shocked that the stone wasn't there. Nor were there any soldiers to be seen. The stone had been rolled away, taken right out of its trough, and tipped over. As we stood and wondered at what had happened to the stone, two men dressed in dazzling white robes suddenly appeared. These garments were not the togas of the Roman soldiers, nor were they the long white robes of the Pharisees. These were not men at all, but they were angels of God. We were overcome and we fell to the ground, but the angels reassured us. They reminded us how Jesus had said that he would rise again. One of the angels bid us to look inside the tomb and see for ourselves. So I ran as fast as I could to tell Peter and John. When we returned, the other women were gone. We looked into the tomb, empty. I was convinced that someone had stolen the body of Jesus. The linen garments Joseph had wrapped him in, they were still lying there, neatly folded in their places. But the tomb was empty, I tell you. Peter and John ran from the garden, but I remained. I didn't have anywhere to go. What had happened to the master? Could it be that he actually did rise from the dead, or had the soldiers taken his body away? My heart was overcome with sorrow. I just stood there weeping. Then I heard a voice behind me ask, "Woman, why are you weeping?" I assumed that it was the gardener. "Sir, what have you done with him?" I asked. It was fully light, but tears blurred my eyes. I turned but could not see clearly. Then he called me by name. "Miriam," that's my Aramaic name, the name my parents and my friends called me. The gardener would not have spoken Aramaic to me. A Roman would not know my name. I knew that voice. I looked up and I saw him. It was Jesus. I answered in Aramaic, "Rabboni." I threw myself at his feet, weeping, laughing, not believing. My master, my teacher, my savior, my Lord, he was standing there alive. Of course, I become one of the 12 voices of Easter, a voice of astonishment and wonder, the first human voice of adoration. He told me to go tell the others, and I did. Marvelous news, a wonder beyond all wonders. God has accomplished great things in our midst. Jesus is risen from the dead. Amen. Then there's the voice of Cleopas. The road before us was hard and colorless. It was springtime, but we were deaf to the birds singing in the trees. We were blind to the flowers blooming in the field. The sun gave no warmth. The sky had no color. Jesus the Nazarene was dead. We were full of questions and doubts. We'd been in Jerusalem for the Passover. It was only a few miles from our village of Emmaus. But instead of celebrating the Feast of Deliverance with joy, we observed the crucifixion of our deliverer with despair. We were at Golgotha. We saw him die. I had come to believe that Jesus was the Messiah. My friend and I were both his disciples. Not chosen to be among the 12, but disciples nonetheless. We followed him. We listened to him preach. We submitted to his instruction. We believed his words. We expected to see him established as God's anointed king on earth, the hope of Israel, the light of to all the nations, but instead we saw him crucified. Falsely convicted by our leaders and executed by the Romans, he was gone. When he died, all of our hopes died with him. The crucifixion was Friday. We stayed in the city through the Sabbath. The weight of his death grew on us each hour until it seemed that we would be crushed completely. On the morning of the first day, we prepared to return to Emmaus. There was nothing more to do in Jerusalem. There was some chance the authorities would arrest any disciples of Jesus that they could find. Those who stayed in the city were keeping out of sight. So as we prepared to leave, we heard some rumor that his grave was empty. Someone had heard. It was whispered that the woman had seen him alive. Another snatch of news had it that Peter and John had been to the tomb and seen it empty. But who knew for sure? There was just no way to know. So we took to the road. We walked some distance in sad conversation. Then we became aware of footsteps behind us, a man walking by himself. We let him join us. He asked what we were talking about. Why do you look so glum, he said. At first, neither my friend or I responded. Was he in sympathy or would he betray us? Finally, I whispered, where have you been for the last few days? Haven't you heard what's happened in Jerusalem? Are you a stranger here? How could anyone within miles of the city not know what has happened? This was no common execution. 3 hours of thick darkness covered the land. Never had earthquakes accompanied a crucifixion. How could this stranger be so ignorant of everything that had happened? But he did seem sincere. We told him that the one expected to redeem Israel had been crucified and placed in a grave. His death was the end of our hopes. There could be no deliverance now. We even told him the rumors that some of the women had gone to the tomb that morning and found it empty. Peter and John went too. But what could have happened to the body? Who would have had reason to have moved it? And what about the Roman guards? We admitted these stories were hard to believe. The stranger shook his head at our confusion. He chided us for not believing the promises of the Scripture regarding the Messiah. Then he taught us. He quoted passage after passage from Moses and the prophets and David, showing us how the promises must be fulfilled, how the Messiah must suffer first before he began his reign, how his death would atone for sin, and that God would not leave him in the grave, but would raise him to life again. Our hearts quickened to hear those words of promise and new hope. By the time we arrived at our village, it was late in the afternoon. Traveling after dark was terribly dangerous because of the thieves on the road. So when we saw that the stranger intended to go alone, we persuaded him to stay. He accepted our invitation and came to dine with us. We reclined together at the table. The stranger took up bread, blessed it, broke it, and we began to eat. That's when I noticed him. Those marks on his hand. When he broke the bread, I caught my breath. I said, show me your hands. He held them out and turned them over. Nail prints. I raised my head and looked him full in the face. His eyes held my gaze, and I knew him. My heart pounded in my chest. I was looking in the face of Israel's Redeemer, Jesus, the Messiah, our teacher, alive from the tomb. The women were right. Peter and John, they were not talking nonsense. He was alive. He's in my house. He's reclining at my table. I looked across at my companion. He too had recognized the teacher. When we looked back, Jesus was gone. I stood up quickly. We have to go to Jerusalem. We must tell everybody what has happened. My companion said, are you crazy? We've been on the road all day. Now it's after sunset. It's too dangerous. I picked up a heavy walking stick. We left everything and rushed back to Jerusalem. It was a 7-mile journey. It was the most exciting journey of my life. If there were bandits, we never saw them. But in the city, we found the place where the disciples were hiding. And we burst in. Peter, James, John, and the others, we told them. Then we told them again. And they told us what they had seen. That small room could barely contain us. Yes, I'm one of the 12 voices of Easter. I'm Cleopas. And mine is the voice of assurance. I tell you today what I know is true. Jesus is alive. I've seen him. I've looked the resurrected Christ straight in the eye. I've heard him teach. I've eaten bread broken by his nail-scarred hands. Now there's no more questions, no more doubt, only this assurance. I've seen him. He's alive. Here's the 12th. Thomas, he was gone. My master gone, departed. All of our plans ruined. All of our hopes shattered. He was nailed to a cross and died. And then they took him down and put his body in a grave. It was all over now. I'm Thomas, one of the 12. I loved him. I was devoted to him. I believed him. In fact, I was ready to die for him. When news came that his friend Lazarus died, Jesus told us he was going to Bethany where the family lived. But that would be dangerous. His enemies would be at hand, and those who wanted Jesus dead might find their opportunity. So I would not let him go alone. I got the others to agree, and we went with him, even though it could have meant death for us too. It eventually meant death for him. Now, of course, I remember his teaching. I understand now that he was telling us what would happen. But none of us could see it at that time. He said he was going away to prepare a place, and we didn't know what he meant. And so I just asked, Lord, we don't know where you go. So how do we know the way? And I wasn't doubting. I just didn't understand. Always learn better when I get to see something to go with the words. At the end, I saw something to go with his words about leaving us. The horror of Golgotha. After that, we fled. We feared for our lives. We thought the chief priest or the Roman soldiers might come after his disciples next. So we hid in homes around Jerusalem through the Sabbath. The next morning, Peter and John and some of the women went to the tomb. They came back saying the tomb was empty, claiming Jesus had risen from the dead. That night, they all met in secret. And later, they told me that Jesus visited them and then disappeared. But I just couldn't believe it. A dead man from a grave alive? I remembered Lazarus coming out of the grave, but Lazarus didn't mysteriously appear and disappear through locked doors. And Lazarus had he had a whole body. His back had not been stripped of flesh. His side had not been opened by a Roman spear. No, I said, unless I can put my hands in the print of the nails in his hand, unless I could see and touch that horrible gash in his side, unless I could see with my eyes and touch with my hands and have proof that he was alive, I could not believe. The other disciples still insisted that they had seen him alive. Two of them that he had walked with on the road with them to Emmaus. Mary Magdalene told again how she met him in the garden. They urged me with their personal experience, but I couldn't believe without seeing for myself. I had to see for myself. I didn't want to hear about it. I wanted to see it. I wanted to touch it. I wanted to know myself that he was alive, because I'm the voice of doubt. A week later, we all gathered in the same room where the others claimed to have seen him before. Suddenly, he was there. Jesus appeared in our midst. I knew he didn't come through the door. The door was locked, because we were afraid. And he greeted us. Then he turned to me. My heart pounded. His eyes looked straight into mine. He reached out and took my hands in his. He spoke my name. Thomas, put your finger here in my hands. Place your hand in the wound in my side and believe. He knew how I had doubted. He knew exactly what I had said. I had said I would not believe unless I saw the print of the nails in his hands. He said, see my hands? I told the disciples I couldn't believe unless I put my finger in those nail prints. He said, put your finger here. I said I would not believe unless I could put my hand in his side. And he said, put your hand here in my side. I touched the marks of the soldiers and the chief. The marks of the men who rejected him, despised him, and cruelly abused him. They were marks of men who would not believe. Marks of unbelief, scars of doubt. Those marks were my marks. How was I any different? I was the man who would not believe. Mine were the nails. Mine was the spear. The scars were the marks of my disbelief. I fell to my knees and said, my Lord and my God, what about you? To any of you who doubt that Jesus is alive, to any who doubt that he is the risen, living Lord, to any who doubt that he is God, I, Thomas, say doubt no longer, but believe. He rebuked me gently as the others watched. He said, I believe because I had seen, but he said, even greater blessing would be upon those who have not seen as I have and yet would believe. When you come face to face with the resurrected Christ, the voice of doubt is silenced. It gives way to the voice of faith, to the voice of hope. Because this Jesus, this Lord, this God is not in a Jerusalem grave. He's alive.
Amen.
I doubt no more. And our hopes, they live again. Now the promises of God have come true. The Lord is risen indeed. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for the truth of the story of your love for us. Lord, I thank you tonight that we're able to look in Scripture of the events of some 2,000 years ago, and we're able to feel and sense how much you really loved us. And Lord, you are able to do that from standing at that place, looking through the corridors of our lives and seeing how we would fail you, how we would go through times of rejection of you in our lives. And yet, before any of those things happened, and you were aware of all of those, you were still willing to give your life for us. And God, tonight, I stand humbled at that point. Bless us as we depart this place tonight. And bless our service on Resurrection Sunday. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.